Christy Prashita, and Neeraj, and I'm very happy to be here and interacting with you on various aspects of environment. So before we start, I want to know that many of you are taking some research topics on environment. Would you like to mention a few, like who all are working on environment? Anyone? Which topic have you chosen?
Air pollution.
Air pollution. What about you?
Fossil fuels.
The pollution in the Yamuna.
Yamuna pollution.
Tigers.
Tiger is also basically your mascot, right?
I think also.
One person from there also.
Water pollution.
Okay. So we have mostly covered the burning issues of today: air pollution, water pollution, and of course tigers. So which is great. And so today, before we start discussing about the environmental topics, can I just introduce our work which we do in our organization? So we come from Center for Science and Environment. It's an NGO which works on the areas of environment advocacy and research particularly. So we have worked on various issues like cola, pesticides. It was discovered 20 years back that there is pesticide found in cola. So our organization worked proactively in that. Even in Delhi, living in Delhi, you must have seen CNG buses flying on the roads, the public buses. So in 1990s and 2000s, there was a lot of air pollution, worse, much worse than what it is today. So the organization fought hard to get in CNG public buses so that the pollution level goes down, because they were all diesel run by then. So it was a hard-fought battle, but we did get it. But today, after 20 years, we are back to square one, because we have so many vehicles running on the road, so the air pollution levels are going higher and higher every day. So the organization, and we come from Environmental Education Unit. So there are different sections of areas of environment which we work in, and we work in Environmental Education Unit. We work with schools and teachers and students in schools in order to strengthen the environmental education in classrooms, right? So, and we have a program for that, which is called Green Schools Program. So it's basically an online run program wherein students are, you know, given activities to go out and explore the environment in their school and come up with their information and feedback. And that feedback is fed into the online portal system in the form of a report. So that report we get, and we analyze the report of every school, how is it doing in water management, how is the school faring well, is it spreading the information well about waste management or segregation of waste at source. So this is what we kind of try to achieve through the program. So basically, once the schools submit their reports to us, we kind of rate them as green school or yellow or orange or red, right? So if they are good with environmental practices and infrastructure, they are basically green schools. So, and the sections which we talk about in audit, they are subdivided into six sections: air, energy, food, land, water, and waste. And as we just discussed today, we had all the research topics which you mentioned mostly fell under air, water, and the biodiversity one would fall under land. So basically every section talks about, you know, activities and questions for the students to prod further. So for example, in air, we ask students, how do you travel to school? So how do all of you commute to the school from your homes? By bus, by public bus or school bus, right? So that's a good thing, because you all carpool or you take a sustainable mode of transport instead of taking private vehicles. Then we ask them, how well is your classroom well ventilated? So because unless your class is air conditioned, which also we discourage in most of the schools, it should have enough openable windows, right, to allow air ventilation. But in Delhi, it's difficult to say that, because air outside is not as good in winter especially. In energy, we encourage schools to take up energy efficiency. So anyone would like to mention what is energy efficiency?
Not keeping all the lights on.
Yes, that could be one way of achieved in schools? Any ideas? Yes.
Keeping lights on when like they're not using them.
Yes. That's right. So if you don't need electricity, if you don't need lights, you can switch them off. That's one way of achieving that. And many schools are actually demonstrating such practices. We do try to bring in schools' attention towards renewable source of energy. Have you heard of renewable sources of energy? What kind of renewable sources?
Air, water.
Air, water, that's right, yes. Wind and solar, that's right. So in India especially, there is a huge potential to get solar energy generated, right, through solar panels, because we have a lot of sun and summers are long. So energy is one. Then food. What kind of food do you eat in schools? Is the food, packaged food, more packaged food, or is it freshly prepared? What kind of food do you consume in school? Freshly prepared, are you sure? Even outside school, do you only consume freshly prepared food, or do you like having packaged foods? No? No packaged foods? Sometimes. Okay, and what about pizzas and burgers? That's good or not? Sometimes, but most of the students like it, right? But of course, we discourage that because it's not very nutritious. In land, we talk about biodiversity and land use pattern in schools. For example, in your school, how much greenery do you have? There has to be some section of land which must have plantations or plants planted in that area to allow to have more and more greenery and definitely to give fresh oxygen. And also how is the land pattern utilized in the school? For example, some schools may have very less area given to playgrounds, and more area in concretized buildings. So that's also not good. And what about the biodiversity aspect of it? So we ask schools, how many species of plants do you observe in your school? Like how many, what different kinds of plants are there or not. So we talk about diversity. It has to be diverse. You can't be having only one kind of tree throughout, right? And one kind of, and what about the animals? Because if you ask students to go find out how many animals did you find, the students are given this impression that you should not allow any animal to get inside the school. Not even a dog should enter. Isn't that so? Do you have animals in your school? Any kind of animals?
Yes.
Like?
Cats
and
birds.
That's it?
Squirrels.
Squirrels. Monkeys. You observe monkeys in the school?
Yes.
They come inside. Okay. What else? Insects, that's right. Generally ignore insects. I'm sorry?
Reptiles,
lizards. Even mosquitoes. They're under animal kingdom, right? So and butterflies, different kind of insects. So all of them fall under animal kingdom. So we encourage students to go find out how biodiverse your school compound is. Then we talk about water. Water is a very important and crucial topic at this point of time, right? Because we all see, especially in India, we see that rainfall patterns are completely disturbed, right? And not only that, we've seen the groundwater levels depleting and a lot of other issues, we're seeing them. But the school level, they can do a lot in order to encourage students to harvest rainwater, not waste water, right? So for example, we're just having a discussion with Michael today that students are encouraged to bring bottles, which I can see here, that most of the students are carrying their own bottles, which is a great thing, right? Instead of buying a new plastic bottle, new packaged water bottle, you can carry your own bottle. So, and also many schools have started this initiative that even if students fill their own bottles, if they want to get, because it's summer, then they want to have cold water, they'll just spill the water out and refill the bottle. So even the schools are wondering on that they should not allow students to spill even a drop of water. They can collect it in some container and then reuse it later, right? So likewise in water and also wastewater management, right? Do you have wastewater recycling system in your school, treatment system? Do you have? You don't know about it. Will you go find out? Yeah, you can go find it. You can ask your teachers or somebody, do we recycle water or treat water in our compound, right? Okay. Coming to waste management is a big issue again. And it's unfortunate that we are facing all the issues here, and but it's great that we can start working on it, at least, to bring down the impact. And all of these, you know, issues are somehow related to the bigger problem we are facing on Earth today. Could you name it?
Global
warming, right? Somehow or the other, it's all connected, interconnected. So, going forward, the waste section, we have many issues like segregation of, starting from segregation of waste at source until the last, you know, the last stage of the waste where it goes. So, so we do have all the sections connected to the main, you know, issue of climate change. So we'll go one by one and we'll discuss like how each and every section could be connected. For example, in air, how do you think air is connected to climate change or global warming? Greenhouse gases. Where do they come from? From the fossil fuels. That's right. That's your topic of research as well. Great. Okay. So we do have air and emissions coming out from various sources, including industries, including you know, vehicles, or you know, the livelihood industry, methane emissions. So different kind of fossil fuel related emissions and other greenhouse gas emissions are leading to global warming and climate change. We have the other section. The next section is energy. How do you think energy is related to climate change? Is it related to climate change? Yes, it is. How? Where do you get energy from?
Like
if that helps.
Fossil fuels that we said earlier.
Yes.
Power plants.
So, fossil fuels, obviously, coal and petrol and gas, natural gas, they are used in power plants to generate electricity, and that's what we are getting from the electricity we are getting from. So, that's how it's contributing to climate change. Then we have the next section being food. So how do you think food is contributing to climate change? Animals, yes. Consumption of, yes.
Well, it takes up a lot of like land, which is contributes to biodiversity, and then also animals don't have anywhere to live anymore because it's huge farms.
Animals industry, the slaughterhouse, the beef industry, the, you know, so all these combined, they contribute to greenhouse gas emissions, especially methane emissions, and account for close to 1/3 of the carbon emissions on Earth, right? So definitely food is one important part. Also, you know, when we talk about food, it comes from different areas of the world. For example, if you want to consume some sort of exotic food, so let's say I want to consume apple from California. So it will come from, how will it come from California? Right. It will use some fossil fuels to reach here, right? So that's how food could contribute to climate change. And it is, definitely. If we consume local food, you know, more biodiverse food, which is available in the area, same area, then we would contribute lesser. Okay, next one being that. That is biodiversity. How do you think biodiversity or land could be related to climate change? Yes. And which was the most recent one we have changed?
Australia
bushfires. And Amazon, of course. That was also big. So, and also, you know, destroying forests, forests being destroyed due to forest fires, also not planting enough forests. For example, if you say that we want to develop, you want to, you know, bring in development, you want to build roads and buildings and infrastructure, you also have to keep in mind of the plants which need to be, you know, regrown in case we are cutting them for development. So for example, if you say that I want to build a new road on this stretch and there are, you know, good forest, old plants going there, growing there. So in that case, I need to ensure that there is a forest being grown somewhere, and in fact, most of the times we should grow double the number of plants because the regeneration rate, the survival rate also, you know, differs from different plants. Huh. What about water? Is water anyhow related to climate change?
Well,
not be directly contributing to climate change, water in some as such, but the impact of climate change is seen as, you know, in the water section. For example, one is sea levels rising because the glaciers are melting, and the other one being the disturbed rainfall patterns. You know, a lot of floods and droughts, especially in India. If you see, last year we saw a record rainfall, right? And also the droughts were very high. Number of droughts were very high. The same area we had droughts, the same area we had floods as well. So it's kind of becoming really bad because of climate change. And the last one being waste, right? Waste. So what do you think waste, how do you think waste for us directly related to climate change? How do you think it is? What do you, like, what do you, yes?
Plastic,
yes. One is plastic. Hey, that's fine. We have more points. These are just a few. You can add so many other points from your side if you have it. Yes.
Maybe even oil spills.
Oil spills?
Right.
Yes. Waste, that's an idea.
Fossil fuels have to go through this cleaning process so it can be usable.
Right.
So that waste.
Right, that's right. That's a lot of waste, yes. What about consumption? Like, what about our consumption patterns? Would you like to give a thought to that? Like, how much do we consume? For example, let's talk about clothes. Like the clothes we wear. Just give it a thought. How many pair of new clothes do you buy a month? And for preparing for, you know, manufacturing the clothes, you need raw material, right? And if you keep buying a lot, because nowadays fashion changes so quickly, you know, and you want to keep up with that, you want to keep up with the trends and all. So if you keep buying a lot of clothes and you keep, you know, discarding them, then where does it go? It goes, most of the times in the landfills or wastes, if it's not recycled, right? So consumption pattern does matter, right? So it's been said that one of the researches happened in Himachal Pradesh, where they found that as the, you know, level of the living standard of the people rise, the amount of waste they generate also increases proportionally. So we have to keep a very strict watch on how much we consume. Do we need it? Before we buy, we have to think if we need it, right? So there's a lot of thought which has to go into that as well. So with that, we now go to the next section, which we'll talk about. We'll take you to through an activity. But before that, we'll just give a small discussion about waste management, right? So plastic, per se. Plastic is kind of an enemy as a friend, right? Because most of the products which are made nowadays are plastic. The chairs we are sitting in, the spectacles we are wearing. So many good things come from plastic, but there has been a lot of mismanagement when it comes to plastic waste. And especially single-use plastic. It's been banned in most of the places, but still people are using it, right? And on the world level, it's said that only 10% of the waste, plastic waste, gets recycled. Rest all of it either ends up in landfills or, you know, just is in the oceans. You know that? In the oceans. There's a this kind of a plastic island, or, you know, developing in the middle of the ocean somewhere where not even humans, no humans can go. Still, they found a lot of plastic accumulating there. So, plastic management is an important area here. So, first of all, the first mantra we want to, you know, propagate here is, first of all, you should refuse plastic. If you don't need it, please refuse it, right? You should reduce the use of plastic as much as you can. If you don't think that it's needed here, reduce it. And if you do use it, try to. What? If you use it, what do you do? Reuse it. And after reusing a lot of times, when it light goes off, what do you do? Recycle. How do you recycle? Yes, there are a lot of recycling agencies who take plastics from you and they can recycle it. And there are some waste to energy plants running, where they burn the plastic in a controlled manner and generate energy from it. So that's also happening now. There are different ways of disposing of plastic. we learn about it as we go forward, and we have an interesting activity for all of you to coming up. So I'll invite my colleague Tushita to take you to the activity.
Right, okay. So my name is Tushita, and as Aditi has already told you, we are consuming a lot of plastic, probably when it's not even needed. For example, this. And this meme is my segue into the activity that we're going to be doing. So a recent study says that humans consume at least one credit card, plastic weight equivalent to one credit card per year. And if we keep consuming the amount of plastic we do now, we'll be consuming 5 credit cards by 2050, right? So I don't think we're all ready to do that. So let's do one quick activity. Let's try to gauge our plastic consumption.
May I ask a clarifying question? By consumption, you mean we're essentially eating plastic.
Yes.
That's what you're referring to.
Yes.
Not just using it, but it's
yes.
in our body.
Yes. As
in our
body.
In one credit card per
we're
year.
We're eating plastic.
Woo!
The water and food everywhere.
It's in our water. Okay. So this is a plastic calculator. This is essentially going to calculate how much plastic we use in a week. We could do a week, so that's more realistic. I will need a volunteer now. So can somebody please volunteer? You just have to answer honestly. That's all you have to do. And really basic questions. So do we have a volunteer? Great. May I know your name?
Myra.
Myra. Thank you so much for volunteering. Okay. So let's begin. So the first category is food and kitchen needs. Pet bottles. So Myra, how many pet bottles do you think you use in a week?
What do you mean by?
Like Coke, beverages that you drink, water bottles that you buy probably?
Three.
Okay. Right, plastic bags. Could be garbage bags, could be cloth, like bags you use
five.
To put in clothes and stuff.
Five.
Five? Okay, great. I like that you're answering honestly. Food wrappers. It could include takeaway food. Eight. Great. I mean, not great, but honestly, great. Yogurt containers. That's oddly specific. So, how many yogurt containers?
Zero.
Great. You don't need yogurt. Okay. Next is bathroom and laundry. So the categories are pretty much general, so try to think of all that you use in this category and not essentially what's listed here. Cotton swabs, plastic, not the wooden ones.
Oh, five.
Okay, detergent, cleaning product bottles, everything that's plastic when it comes to bathroom.
In half a year?
We could do a month.
Just one.
Okay, so this includes all the products that you use, detergent, soaps, body wash, everything of this. So one you say? Like one huge bottle.
Sure.
Okay. Do this for 1 month. Shampoo, shower gel, cosmetic, bottles, everything. Four?
Yeah, four.
So this includes your face wash, your creams, your ointments, everything. Okay. Refill packets. Could be hand wash, could be face wash. Okay. In a month.
Zero.
No refills? Because you buy huge bottles. Toothbrushes. How many in a month? Or let's do 3 months?
One.
Toothpaste?
Two.
Three
in
months.
Two.
Takeaway plastic. This is interesting. Now food. Takeaway plastic boxes. How many in a week?
Two.
Okay. Takeaway plastic cups.
One.
Nice. Straws. How many in a month?
It's plastic straws?
Yeah, plastic straws.
Four.
In a month. That's in a month. Disposable cutlery.
Oh, zero.
No? Okay. You don't order in often or you don't take away much? Plastic plate. toys, furnitures, etc. So just have to give me a rough number, how many kgs a year.
Mm-hmm.
So it could be chairs, tables and stuff that you use, any toys that you have, any gadgets that you have. So rough number, how many kgs a year?
15.
Right. So Myra's plastic footprint is 39.1 kg per year, which is 2,934 kg in the entire lifetime. What is the global average that we see here? Global average of consumption. That's 50 kg per person. USA mostly consumes 84 kg. Europe is 30, and Myra is way ahead of Europe at 39.1. So that is the amount of plastic you use, and it's alarming, and it, I think, encourages you to reduce your plastic consumption then, once you know how much you're doing, right? And how it's well above what other countries are doing. Okay, so is there anybody who claims to use more plastic than Myra does? Or any other volunteer to do this one more time?
Do I have to answer 100% honestly?
I would say 200% honestly. Okay, so what is your name?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So how many pen dumps in a week?
I'm not buying on this zero. I have
okay, so we trust you. Plastic bags? Okay. Food wrappers, how many in a week?
Three.
Yogurt containers?
I don't have yogurt
now. No yogurt? Does anyone like yogurt here?
I like yogurt.
What is yogurt?
What is yogurt?
What's yogurt?
Okay, that's fat free curd. It's baking as well. Okay. Cotton swabs?
What is cotton swabs?
That's something to use
yeah.
on your ears.
Stuck in your ears with
okay, detergent, cleaning product, bottles. How many in a month? Shampoo, shower gel, cosmetics include everything here. All the bottoms that you use, plastic bottles.
Oh, I think maybe it's half a year though. I use the plastic too.
Okay, 2 in 6 months. How many refills in a month?
Includes
your gadgets.
Oh.
The plastic that's used in your gadgets. And all the e-waste that you create for your electronic solution.
Wow.
Okay, so Myra was 39. This is 38.4. Just 2 in 7 cases.
It may be
better than the first volunteer, but still alarming, right? The amount that you consume is still alarming. So this is just a quick activity. This is just a quick activity to give us an idea of how much plastic we are consuming and in what form we are consuming it, because the first reason to stop it is that it's going inside us, and that's, I think, the last thing we want with plastic. Right, so what are, yes?
Can I
Oh, sorry, I had a quick question. If
yeah.
Is this something that's online that each all of us can do?
I could give you the link. It's
that'd be very
right? Okay, there are different types of calculators. In fact, use the plastic one.
Okay.
Right. So what are some of the alternatives to plastic? What could we do? So we now know the problem. Yes, how can we reduce our plastic consumption? Just a quick idea.
Reusable water bottles.
Water bottles to avoid PET bottles. That's good, yeah. Okay, you could carry your own glass or mug. You were saying something?
No.
No, that's fine. Any other ideas? Yes?
In India, they're increasingly getting better about non-plastic straws and cutlery that's made out of wood instead of metal. So if there's a choice between taking plastic or that, you can certainly do that. Also, I've noticed does anyone use Zomato? Or their families use Zomato, like delivery stuff?
We'll do
this. They have this check box that says, please don't give me cutlery.
That is true.
Which I thought was very cool because potentially you're already at your house and you have access to your own forks and napkins and all that kind of stuff. So why do you need them to bring it to you?
Number of great ideas. That's great. Any other ideas that we have here to reduce our plastic consumption? Because all this works. All this is what you can do in your real life right away, right? And this is going to make a huge impact in the long term. So this is where we take your questions. Not just we will be done, right? Is there anything that you want to add?
No, we can take some questions.
So now we can take questions. If you have any questions related to environment, plastic, just everything, you can put forth your questions now. Okay? Just maybe take a few minutes and come up with all the questions that you have, all the doubts.
All the questions, should I use the questions that we wrote last time?
Sure, you can. I sent you your questions that you brainstormed. Did everybody get that? Should have gotten an email from me yesterday.
And can we do something real quick? I'm sensing the energy in the room is a little bit low. Can we stand up for a second and take a breath? Because if we're engaging our minds, we need to make sure that it has some oxygen to ask really great and thoughtful questions, you especially.
Did you get the questions?
We stretch a little bit. Will you give two different people a high five? Awesome. I love that. Nice big deep breaths. Awesome. Take a seat. Whenever you're ready. Question about your services. Actually, have we been rated? AES?
No.
We have not been rated.
You need to register your service first. That's when we rate you.
Okay.
So we can take you through the program if you want. We can take you to the website.
We can certainly do that afterwards. I'd be interested in making a recommendation for us to see where we are.
Either it was very interesting or it was not interesting at all. Which one was it? You can be honest.
Interesting. Okay. I think they need some time to process their
no
questions.
So
would you
like to move on to another activity by the time, or you have questions?
What's the origin of all these problems? All these problems must be because of something. So what's the origin?
Where did it start? Like, what was the point of origin? Is what this question is. Okay, you take moments. Yes. You want to answer it?
Yeah.
Go ahead, please. Human impact. So we've had. Yes, please.
Can I also answer?
Yes.
Crop burning in Haryana and Punjab.
Crop burning is one of the reasons of air pollution. He's talking like, he's saying, where have all these problems originated? Either all the problems. He's talking about all the problems.
Or one thing.
You were asking about one specific problem or all the problems?
All the problems.
Yeah. All the problems.
What's there?
Give her a second to answer it, guys. Give her a second to just kind of think about it and answer it, right? She's the expert. We're the ones that are asking the questions, right? So let's make sure we give her an opportunity to
No, there is, you cannot have one single answer to anything. But of course,
what is the connection between the NGO and the government?
NGO and government.
Okay. Good question.
Any more questions? Yes.
How do these environmental issues affect the economy?
Environmental issues, how do they affect the economy? Yes. That's also a very good question. Okay, so we'll take these questions first and then we can come up with the next thought, right? Where do the problems come from? So has anyone read the history of, let's say, Earth? If not us, have you read the history of Earth? How old is Earth?
Very, very old.
Very, very old. And how old are humans?
I read it a long time ago, so I don't think it's my
own. Yes,
I think if it was, if the Earth was one day, we live 3 seconds.
Yes, yeah. Very rightly put. Earth is around 4.8 billion years old, and humans are here only for some 10,000 years. So basically, we are just here for seconds, if we say it's for one day. If Earth is one day old, we're just here for seconds. And does anyone know about other, problems which existed before humans came? Has anyone read about it, that the problems which existed before humans came to Earth, the environmental problems I'm talking about? Has anyone heard of Ice Age? Have you seen the movie Ice Age? Right? So Ice Age was a phase, right? After every few, some million years, there would be a phase which would end up in Ice Age, and then again the temperature would rise. So basically it was a cycle, right? But what has happened in the past some 100 years, some 200-300 years, you've seen a very extreme rise in the temperatures, right? And you must have heard about 1 degree challenge or 1.5 degree threat which we are facing. So if the temperatures rise above 1.5 degree or 2 degrees, then the sea levels will consume. The sea levels, like for example, if we see, talk about Mumbai in India, or if we talk about the coastal areas around the world, most of the coastal cities will be submerged, you can see, right? So basically, the problems have come from humans. So when humans started, consuming too much, exploiting too much environment, too much of the resources of the environment, the problems started accumulating. And within the last 200 years, we have destroyed most of the biodiversity. We have, brought about too many extinctions. The freshwater bodies have been reduced to wastewater bodies. So a lot of problems have been brought about. So we do need to kind of watch what we as humans do, right? So that could be one small reason, but it's not to be a very bad impact to the environment. So of course, humans is one reason. And I think that's the core problem is consumption patterns. So we need to watch on how much and what we consume. We need to shift towards sustainable, choices, which we can try, right? Okay. The second question was, what is NGO and government? What is the connection between NGO and government? Is that the question? So basically, they are not connected at all. NGOs work independently of the governments, right? So they kind of watch what the governments are doing. They kind of bring feedback to the government. For example, if there is something, some new policy which has come up, right? For example, a new policy says that the waste has to be segregated at source. That's the policy of waste management in the country. Then the NGOs will work and see what are the loopholes which the people are exploiting, or how can the policy make better. For example, if the waste segregation has to happen, it has to happen not only for dry and wet waste, but different other kinds of waste. So newer things have to be added. For example, e-waste management has to be done separately. Although it's dry waste, but it's electronic waste. So it has to be dealt with in a different manner. Because you can't be, an electronic waste consists of different heavy metals, different, other kind of, other material. So it has to be dealt with in a different manner. So different feedback mechanism works there. And also it's kind of, how people are liking or not liking stuff. For example, if the government comes up with a policy of for tribal rights, right? That this much forest belongs to tribals or not. Then the NGOs who work in that sector will bring the feedback from people to the government. They kind of voice the people's concerns to government. Right? So there are different ways NGOs work in implementation, in research, in advocacy, different sectors NGOs work. So that's how the relation or equation is. If anyone wants to add anything, right? So third question was on environment and economy. What do you think? Does environment and economy, does it you know, run in silos? What is environment? What do you think is environment?
Everything natural.
Everything natural. Right, that's very good. And what is economy?
Money.
It's all money, right? So do you think they are both mutually exclusive? They have nothing to do with each other? No? Environment and economy run, yes.
They have something to do with prices of certain energy sources?
Yes. That's one example. So, everything which economy works on, for example, we have to, if we talk about energy, right? Where do we get the energy from? We get it from power plants, and power plants get their raw material from fossil fuels. And where do we get the fossil fuel from? The earth, mines, etc. Right? So basically, you cannot say that they are all disconnected from each other. They're all connected. So obviously, environment does have an impact on the economy, and vice versa. Right? So they're definitely connected to each other. If we say that, for example, there is a lot of talk about we should shift to renewable sources of energy because we are running out of fossil fuels. They are limited sources of energy, right? If we don't have them, then how will our cars run? How will we get the electricity? What will our, you know, day-to-day life will be impacted? So definitely we have to think about other options. So that's how, and if, and that's completely dependent on the economy. So we have to pay for the electricity, we have to pay for the petrol and diesel to buy, you know? So that's how they work, they both work hand in hand. But of late it has been happening that humans, because of their various reasons, greed or whatever you call it, we keep exploiting the earth without thinking about regeneration of it, right? So what happens is, for money, for weed, whatever, we keep, you know, exploiting, we keep mining more and more material, raw material and elements from the earth without thinking about what impact does it bring on the ground, on the biodiversity, on environment, on air pollution, on water, etc. So that's why we are right now on a very bad state because we have exploited too much and we've not thought of the regeneration. So again, we are not on a balanced state. But what we want to achieve is a balanced state where people, where environment and where economy all run well without kind of exploiting any of it. Right? Have I confused you enough? Not yet? Okay. Okay. Any more questions do we have? Yes. Basic term about economics, it's demand and supply, right? If you want something, you'll go buy it. And if you buy it, then the vendor will ensure that he sells it to you, right? So if you don't ask for it, they will not make it, right? So the responsibility lies with each of us. It's not some industry or some one section of people working on it. Every one of us has to take responsibility in our own capacity, right? So if we say that, if I say that, okay, I'll take a public bus or I'll take a carpool instead of going on my private car, that means that I'm not consuming that amount of petrol or diesel which the private car would have taken, right? So four people's share of petrol is reduced. that means I'm not asking for that amount of fossil fuel to be mined from the mines, right? So that's what it matters. We need to work on our own consumption. We need to work on our own demand. So definitely there's hope. Of course, there's hope. It's not that all is lost. But the thing is, we can't be thinking about, and you know, when the things will be first, then only they wake up and start working on it. So it should not be like that, right? So definitely there's hope. All of you agree with me? Do we have hope? Can we still save it? That's what, when we're going to make these?
Lemons.
Lemons. Okay. So do you think Leonard said, whatever he said, he has a question about, can we be hopeful? So all of you agree with it? If you don't agree with it, then you have your answer able to Leonard. Are we all prepared to do what we can do at our level? Yes. Can we make good choices? Yes. All right. Second question was on air pollution, right? So you said that how is the people who are living in streets, how are they more exposed to air pollution as compared to us who are living inside, right? That's what you asked. We have access to air purifiers. So, you know, air is one resource which is everywhere. You cannot stop, like water, you can contain it in a container and not allow it to flow. But air is a little different. It can flow from even the small creek there. It can just mix with the outside air, right? So you cannot say that I have made myself completely air pollution proof perfectly. You can never say that. It's always, there is always a chance of polluted air seeping inside your room through the window or the door creak, right? So of course we can try and make air purifiers and in the rooms inside the enclosed buildings, but somewhere or the other you'll have to go out, you know, venture out, or you'll have to open the door at least, right? So there has to be, you cannot be working on the solution on, you know, in the room level. You have to work on a solution which is for the larger picture. You have to work on the basic, the main source of air pollution. That's one point, yes.
You could make it zero if you have a hazmat suit inside.
I'm sorry, if you make it?
If you go outside and you have a hazmat suit, then you have a
mask. You're talking about mask.
No, hazmat suit. You can entirely cover
the suit. The suit, okay. All right.
And
so will you not get out of that suit ever? Right, so the thing is, these are just, solutions which you can think of at your level. But ultimately, you are going to get exposed to the air somewhere or the other, even if it's a little bit, right? I agree with you that we, people sitting here, have, you know, better privilege to be inside the enclosures, wherein we will be less exposed to air pollution outside, but we can never ever rule out the possibility of getting exposed to it at one point of the time, even if it's once or twice a day, right? We do venture out, we do open the doors, etc. So the root cause has to be addressed. We cannot be working on, you know, makeshift arrangements here and there, bandaging the problem. There has to be a root cause. And the root cause is point sources, the sources of air pollution, where it's coming from. So it could be coming from power plants, it could be coming from vehicles. We need to kind of work on the efficiency of those machines and vehicles. So are we have any more questions? We don't have any questions from that side.
Chime in and ask a good question.
You don't have to ask, but I'm just saying.
Chime in and ask good questions.
Alright. We can you know, go over to the next activity. Do we have time for the next activity?
Does the environment have any correlation with the unemployment issue?
Environment and employment.
The unemployment.
The unemployment. Yes and no. So basically, livelihood depends on the resources which are drawn from the earth. So definitely, you know, if you want to create, how do you create employment?
Jobs.
Yeah, how do you create jobs? Like you need to generate work for people, right? That's how you know try to create So how do you work with people? You need to make some plans to go somewhere, right? For example, if I want to create livelihood out of some sort of section, for example, if I want to make people busy, or if I want to make some sort of a museum, let's say, right, for people to see in that area. So I have to kind of come up with a plan, then I have to come up with the raw materials, then I have to bring the people to bring to make it. So there has to be a plan for that. But then I'm also using the lot of the raw material which is going to be used for making that, right? So definitely there is a connection between livelihood and environment.
Nice, quick question. Based on the needs of India, if we could prioritize one thing as we left this room to do that would make the biggest impact, in your opinion, what might that be? We could walk away and do one thing that would have the biggest impact in terms of helping decrease climate change or environmental degradation.
So it depends from person to person. Everyone has different day-to-day activities and lifestyle standards. So if we say, we can give a lot of options here. So one could be consuming less. It could be anything, buying less. If we don't need something, we should not venture into buying it. Another could be what kind of food I eat. I can watch the kind of food I eat. If it's polluting, if it's causing any sort of contribution to the climate change in a big manner, I can watch that, right? I can watch the mobility practices which I have. For example, if how do I commute? I can use more public transport. I can use less of private vehicles, and I can use better vehicles, efficient vehicles. So that's another thing. So I think more or less, what kind of consumption? Because we as we don't work in industries, or we don't have say to the policymakers directly. But what we can do at our level is small contributions, but they do make a lot of, they do add up to the bigger impact. So definitely we can do that.
Any thoughts on those who are sort of in powerful positions, both government and non-government, who deny the problem of climate change? Sorry.
Any thoughts on that? So basically, I don't think I am the right person, because all the bigger scientists, the IPCC, the researchers have said so much about it, and we don't need to say it. Now it's all there. It's out there happening.
But the politicians who are in control of things and business people say.
That's why education matters a lot. So if we educate people, if they had some sort of conscience in the back of the mind that environment is important. It's not that all politicians or all the government people are not, understanding about it. It's some of them. So maybe it's the education or the awareness or the, some sort of benefit. Because generally what happens is, when it comes to money or when it comes to my convenience or comfort, I tend to ignore environment, right? So it has to be bridged. The convenience and environment they go hand in hand. It's not that they are different things. If the air outside is polluted, I cannot be comfortable, right? So it has to be bridged. The gap has to be bridged. So once that connection is established, maybe the understanding or the knowledge, maybe it can help. So I am not sure whether it will help or not, but I can say that it's all happening. It doesn't have to be, you're just ignoring if you're not understanding it. So there has to be a bridge somewhere which establishes that thought in the mind that they're not two different things. They're both the same. Right. Yeah, 2 minutes. We have a video of a school. So basically, it's one of our schools who work with us, and they're a green school.
love to hear what's happening as it's playing.
So this is a school in Patna. It's located in the Bihar state of India. It's a green school. It became green after 2 to 3 years. And the school, their students are demonstrating you know, various infrastructural issues. Like, for example, they have rainwater harvesting on their in the school compound. So you can go also check whether you have it in your school, all the practices which are shown here. And then they're showing that the school children, all of them travel by school buses. They don't take any private vehicles. So earlier they used to be taking private vehicles. Now they've understood the effect of it. School, the lighting system, everything is energy efficient appliances. The children bring home cooked food from their places. And waste is segregated at source in school. Do you also have such bins in school where the waste is segregated? Yes. Then they prepare manure from the biodegradable waste. They make compost out of it. So that's what they're kind of demonstrating here. And all the electronic waste, that, for example, your gadgets or computers, they are sent out for recycling separately. So this is how the school became a green school and they got the award of from our organization. So that's what the video was about. We'll leave the video with you. Maybe you can show it later when the sound is fine. So I'll also introduce you with the website later. Okay, right? So if you are interested in the program. Thank you very much. I hope all of you like this. Please, please send your queries if you have to Michael or anyone. Or for children to use.